Remain standing for the reading of God's word from Ecclesiastes chapter 7, starting in verse 15. In my vain life, I have seen everything. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there's a wicked man who prolongs his life in his evil doing. Be not overly righteous, and do not make yourself too wise. Why should you destroy yourself? Be not overly wicked, neither be a fool. Why should you die before your time? It is good that you should take hold of this, and from that withdraw not your hand, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. Wisdom gives strength to the wise man more than 10 rulers who are in a city. Surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. Do not take to heart all the things that people say, lest you hear your servant cursing you. Your heart knows that many times you yourself have cursed others. All this I have tested by wisdom. I said, I will be wise, but it was far from me. That which has been is far off and deep, very deep. Who can find it out? I turned my heart to know and to search out and to seek wisdom and the scheme of things and to know the wickedness of folly and the foolishness that is madness. And I find something more bitter than death, the woman whose heart is snares and nets and whose hands are fetters. He who pleases God escapes her, but the sinner is taken by her. Behold, this is what I found, says the preacher, while adding one thing to another to find the scheme of things, which my soul has sought repeatedly, but I have not found. One man among a thousand I found, but a woman among all these I have not found. See, this alone I found, that God made man upright, but they have sought out many schemes. Let's pray. Father, your word is true. We trust you when you speak. Your word is good. You tell us what we need to hear. Father, your word can be hard to understand. Lord, give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Give us minds to understand what it is that you're saying in your word to us today. Father, may your spirit be at work in our hearts to open us to receive these things, that we might be comforted and challenged and changed to be more like Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
What have I become, my sweetest friend? Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt, if I could start again a million miles away. I would keep myself, I would find a way.
What would you say if I were to ask you what the Bible means when it says, don't be overly righteous? What would you say to the question, what does the Bible mean when it says not to be too wise or too wicked? What would you say to your neighbor who asked you, why do good people die early and sometimes wicked people live long, prosperous lives, never seeming to receive justice in this earth? How about this one? What would you say if I were to ask you, what does the Bible mean when it says, I've not found one good man in a thousand, I've found one good man in a thousand, but I've not found one good woman? Women, what would you say to that? Well, I don't know what you would say. I can tell you what I said to myself as I prepared this to work on this sermon earlier this week. And what I said to myself is, Pastor Trent, I don't know what I've done to receive this message to preach, but I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry. And you know, we deal with difficult texts up here because we're committed to expositional preaching, and we deal with them at times. But there's times when you receive a passage to preach and you do think to yourself, I would be happy to let someone else preach this message. And this is one of those for me. And I'm not alone in this thinking. I have been reading two books written on Ecclesiastes, written by two pastors, authors, PhDs, wonderful men, one of whom is a president of a Christian college. And with some eagerness, I turned to, as they go through each chapter of Ecclesiastes, I turned to see, what did they say about chapter 7 in our verses? And when I turned there, guess what I found? Nothing. Nothing. I guess it was missing from their Bible. They didn't even apologize for it. They just didn't even say why they weren't going to deal with it. They just moved on. And they're not the only ones. I'm not the only ones. As I went to study this week through prayer and reading and seeking scholars, godly biblical scholars who devote their lives to helping us understand the languages and the nuances of Scripture and what it means. And I'm going to read to you some direct quotes from different scholars so we can all get on the same page together this morning. So here's the first one. This is one of those passages that sets preachers to pacing in their studies, wringing their hands. What does it mean? How do we preach it? The temptation will be great to either skip over it or to preach just a few verses. The challenges for preaching this passage begin with the translation of some Hebrew words. What's a preacher to do when committees of expert translators disagree substantially? Here's another one. These verses may be the most misunderstood in the book. Here's another one. Aside from difficulties in translation and interpretation, it will be a challenge to detect the coherence of this passage and to formulate a single theme that encompasses the various ideas. Now, no unifying theme for a Reformed Presbyterian pastor is a cruel and unusual punishment, I can assure you. We look for those. We want that. Two more. This is one of the more difficult passages and perhaps one of the more notorious passages in Ecclesiastes. The style of the entire passage is peculiarly, if I could say that, redundant and complex, even for Koheleth. And the sense remains obscure. Obviously, the final word on this text has not been written. Thus far, it refuses to yield its secret. Now, you may not know of these scholars unless you are a pastor or an ordained ministry, but let me ask you a question by show of hands. How many of you are familiar with Pastor John Piper? Read any of his books? Okay, good number of you. Right, probably one of the most respected, loved, admired pastors, authors of our day. And he has a ministry. It's Ask Pastor John. And he was asked the question just last year in his 70s to comment on what some of the verses in this passage mean today. And this is what he said in response to our passage today and the question about what it means. He says, "My first thought when I heard this question was, I should not try to answer this question because I'm not sure what it means. I remember over the years returning to these puzzling verses several times and coming away each time after all my efforts to read the commentaries and do the work in Hebrew saying, well, maybe I've got it, but frankly, I'm still not sure. So my second thought was, well, at least I should admit that publicly," which, you know, anything about John Piper, he is that. So, did I wring my hands and pace around my office this week? Yes, I did. Did I walk out of my office several times on prayer walks around the campus and around the church? Yes, I did do that. Am I trusting God and the Holy Spirit to have something for us this morning? Yes, I am. It is the Word of God. Of course I am. And does Pastor Trent owe me big time for giving me this passage? I think we can all agree, by the time we're done, yes, he does. So obviously, there's a bit of scholarly debate going on here, quite a bit over the majority of verses in this passage. And you know, I could sit and explain to you at each sentence, each line or two, the different possible interpretations and the arguments that supports them. But I got to tell you, I think if I did that, we would leave today feeling confused. We would leave today feeling unhelped. And I think the most honest thing I can do today is just tell you that this is a passage that has even the most brilliant minds in the Bible perplexed at times and with different meanings. And so we can do that. We can start there. And I will tell you inevitably where I've landed, and I will also tell you that there are clear points in this passage. And I will tell you, and you will know when we get there, okay? So put your seatbelt on. We're gonna go here. Turning to verse 15, we're going to learn that we are not to be overly righteous nor overly wicked. And the preacher says in verse 15, in my vain life, I have seen everything. There is a righteous man who perishes in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man who prolongs his life in his evil doing. So the preacher says, I've seen everything under the sun. I've studied it, I've thought about it, and I've come to an enigma, a puzzle, and that is that a righteous man perishes in his righteousness, and wicked men at times prolong their life, and a long life at that. And the implication is not just that kind of good people die. The implication is they perish in their righteousness. That is to say, because of the very good work they are doing, the righteous deeds, they perish. And so we think of someone like William Borden, who was born to one of the wealthiest silver mining families in history and had everything laid out before him, all of the opportunity, and turned his back to that and went to become a missionary, went to college, went to become a missionary, decided he would go to Egypt because he needed to learn the native language so that he could bring the gospel to an unreached people. That's a righteous deed. He had a righteous motive in that, to bring the gospel. And because he wanted to bring the gospel, and because he went to Egypt to learn the native language, it was there that he received cerebral meningitis and died as a young man in his righteousness, in his righteousness. And this is just one example of many. We know stories of martyrs and missionaries and single moms who, in their tiredness, are working that third job to provide for the family that get killed in a car accident because they fell asleep. There's no end of stories about this. People dying in their righteousness. And to make matters worse, sometimes wicked people, murderers, extortioners, abusers of all kind, live long lives and seemingly never cases solved and people brought to justice in this life. That's the problem that the preacher sees. It's a problem for him, and it's a problem for us as well. It's unfair, it's confusing, it's frustrating, and disheartening. So he observes this, that he's seen this under the sun, and then he makes this statement that creates more problems for us. He says in verse 16, "Be not overly righteous, and do not make yourself too wise. Why should you destroy yourself? Be not overly wicked, neither be a fool. Why should you die before your time?" Right? These are odd verses. Be not overly righteous. Don't be too wise, but don't be overly wicked. Right? Does that mean we can be a little unrighteous? Maybe we can be a little unrighteous, you know? We can tell white lies. We can cheat on our taxes a little bit. We can drive in the frustrating Naples traffic and flip people off, but we can't get out of our car and punch him in the face. A little unrighteous, but not too much. Is that what it means? Is that what he's saying here? Some commentators really think that he's talking about a moderation in a Christian life that somehow allows for some of that. I don't think that's right. So we're starting here. Tough passage, considerable debate going on. So here's what I'm going to do. We stand up here every week and we tell you to the best of our ability, and with great joy in doing so, what we believe the Bible is saying about a passage. And I will tell you what I think it means, but my heart to help us this morning is I'm going to start with what it doesn't mean, what it cannot mean, okay? What some of these passages cannot mean. And I do that because one of the first principles in biblical interpretation is taking cryptic or confusing passages and bringing them under the light or the lens of clearer statements and principles in the Bible, okay? So does the preacher mean that we need to be less righteous and a little bit wicked and not too wise? And I don't think so. I don't believe it means that because the Bible gives us overwhelming evidence. Think about all the verses and all the preaching you've heard about living a righteous life, right? And to seek wisdom and the promises that it holds, right? If you do a word search for righteousness and wisdom in the Bible, there's numerous verses exhorting you to do that. The book of Proverbs itself is a book that lays out the reasons to seek wisdom and the benefits of being a wise person and living under that. And, you know, Jesus himself said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And one of the best things to do in a book is when you come across something confusing, is look at the own author's words elsewhere in the book. So he's saying, be not overly righteous, don't be too wise. But when we get to the end of Ecclesiastes, the end of this entire letter, this book, this is what he writes, the same author that is writing these confusing passages. He says in Ecclesiastes 12, verses 13, the end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment, every secret thing, whether good or evil. The writer is saying, basically, fear God, keep his commandments. Basically, be wise, be righteous, don't be wicked. Everything will be brought out in the light when we're with him. And so we start with this idea, it can't mean being a little unrighteous or a little bit wicked, okay? But here's what I think is going on. Verse 15 gives us a clue, and that the preacher is concerned with what? He's concerned with the death of the premature death or death of the righteous in their righteous deeds and the wicked who prolong their life, okay? And the Israelites, the Jews, this a common belief would have been in their day and age when this is written, and actually continuing on through the New Testament, which we'll get to, they believed that if a person died young or early or suffered some sort of loss, that it was often caused by their unrighteousness and their sin. And sometimes that is true. Sin does bring those consequences. But they had a strong belief that a premature death or terrible circumstances very well could be the person was not righteous enough. And you really can't blame them, because as you think about all of the Old Testament scriptures, even starting with the Ten Commandments, with the promise of honoring your mother and father, that it may go well with you, that you have long life. There are many, many scriptures that talk about long life attached to righteous living and being people of wisdom. And we see it continuing even in Jesus' day. John 9 tells us this thought pattern, right? That the disciples are walking by a blind man, and his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Generally speaking, righteousness and wisdom leads to long life, and generally speaking, wickedness and sin leads to all sorts of complications, problems, even up to death, but not always. And so I believe the point the preacher is making to the original audience, which is always where you start when you study the Bible, what did it mean to them? I believe the point the preacher's making to the original audience was, don't think you can be overly righteous in order to preserve your life. Right? There's a sense in which they thought, and even we think sometimes in our day, that if we try hard enough, if we're really good people, God will do good things in my life. God kind of owes me. It's this mentality that can kind of, either spoken or unspoken, this belief that kind of puts God in a box. Right? If I'm good enough, then these things will happen, right? That God owes them. And the reality is we ought to live, seek wisdom and live righteous lives. Why? Because that's who God is. And because he tells us over and over in many other clearer scriptures to live this way. Avoid sin, you know? So we do it because it's who he is. And sometimes the righteous perish in their righteousness, and sometimes the wicked, their lives are prolonged in their wickedness. And so the preacher says, this is what I'm saying, this is what he's saying. Then he says, to take hold of this truth, he says in verse 18, it is good that you should take hold of this, and from that withhold not your hand, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. So he's saying, the preacher's saying, take hold of this truth, believe it, live in light of it, do not become legalists or overly righteous, nor be a fool by being overly wicked, which usually leads to punishment and death, though not always. So he makes this observation, and really, rather than explaining why these things are happening, The wicked prolong their life and the righteous perish in the righteousness. Rather than explaining that, he does give us something we can hold on to, an answer. And it's there in verse 18. He said, for the one who fears God shall come out from both of them. Okay, the wicked or the overly righteous. Says he can come out of them. So he says the answer is to fear God, and both can be saved. One commentator writes on this idea of what it means to fear God, and we need to look at it, because if that's the answer, to fear God, if you're overly righteous or wicked, that's the answer. Then what does fear God mean? And you can't go to just one passage, I don't think, and find the most concise, inclusive answer to what it means to fear God. And so you read the Bible as a whole, and you get an answer. And so here's what one commentator says on what it means to fear God. He says, according to the book of Proverbs, the fear of the Lord is a continual, humble, and faithful submission to Yahweh, which compels one to hate evil and turn away from it, and brings with it rewards better than all earthly treasures, the rewards of a love for and a knowledge of God, and long life, usually, confidence, satisfaction, and protection. So he's saying basically fearing the Lord will keep you humble, faithful, and submissive to God, which is the very thing an overly righteous person needs to do and believe. A proper fear of the Lord will correct that sin of over-righteous. And most of the time, it leads to a blessing and a longer life. That's usually the case. And fearing the Lord is the answer. It'll save both of them. Will bring you out of a life of wickedness, because you will hate evil. If you have a proper fear of the Lord, you will hate evil. A little bit of evil and a lot of evil. And you will turn from it. You'll turn your heart and your hands from it. And so the preacher, again, doesn't attempt to explain why these things happen that he's struggling with. But he does tell us what to do. Fear the Lord. That's the answer. So we don't understand why, but we know what to do. That's something we can hold on to. The person who fears God worships him because God is worthy of our worship. And those characteristics, righteousness, holiness, wisdom, those are characteristics of our Father, which we're told to be like our Father. The preacher goes on to tell us that none are righteous, that all sin. In verse 19, he says, wisdom gives strength to the wise man more than 10 rulers who are in a city. So he makes another observation, namely that wisdom brings protection. And he's going to talk about in chapter 9, we're not there yet, but he's going to give an example of this we're going to talk about today, that in chapter 9, the Bible speaks of a poor but wise man in a city whom by his wisdom, the city is saved from a wicked king or an oppressive king. So he makes this comment, right? Wisdom gives strength to wise more than 10 rulers who are in a city. Now, several commentators don't believe that verse 19 is included with 20 to 22. I'm going to toss my hat in the ring, as many other have. I'm going to say that I think it does. And I think it belongs here because, he's been using these parallels. Don't be this, don't be that. He's using these opposite parallels. And I think what the preacher's saying is simply this, that wisdom is good, and it does provide many things. But he's going to go on and tell us, but everybody sins. Okay, everybody sins. I think he's trying to say that while wisdom is good, even the wisest and most gifted people still sin. And he does that in verse 20, the following verse. He says, surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. Okay, now this is a verse we can sink our teeth into, and I would have been happy to preach on verse 20 for the entire sermon this morning. Verse 20, surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. This is one of the most profound components of the gospel message we find anywhere. It's probably the verse that the Apostle Paul had in mind when he wrote Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And he tells us that all have sinned, but Paul also tells us why we sin. So we sin. Everyone sins, and I don't think that's too much of a challenge for you Christians here this morning. If I said you sin, you're like, I know it. Tell me about it. It happened before I got out of bed. I get it. We all sin. But it's important to also think about, why is it that we sin? Why do we all sin? What is that related to? And it's related to Romans 5, where Paul explains very clearly that all who are descendants of Adam after sin are imputed. We have sin in us. We are born with sin, okay? We call this a doctrine. It's the doctrine of original sin. And so what it means essentially is that we all sin. Now we're talking about why do we sin and why is this important? And we're getting there. The reality is we are not sinners because we sin. We are not sinners because we sin. We sin because we were born sinners. And you might think, that sounds great, Aaron, but I don't know how important that is to me. We're going to talk about why that is extremely important. The Jews who lived during the time Ecclesiastes was written, the New Testament, even today, still don't believe in this doctrine. And they're not the only ones. There's a lot of folks, there's churches, church organizations that still don't believe in this doctrine of original sin, that we were born with sin, meaning that you are born, they believe that you're born neutral and both have the capacity to do good or evil, good or evil. And here's the problem, and here's why it's critical to understand this, I believe. Not this that we sin, but why we sin. Because there have been many, many movements in Christian history that are moral and spiritual reform movements. And it usually carries this kind of message. And it's usually based in this doctrine, not believing in it, that we were born in sin. And it usually carries these types of messages with it. You can do better. You can do it. Just try harder. Just pray harder. You just need to have more faith. Oh, you're struggling today? Did you do your devotions? Have more faith. Give more money. You can do it. And all of those things are good things until they're corrupted in that way. And we start to become modern-day Pharisees with all of our rules and all of our over-righteousness trying to accomplish what we cannot accomplish. And the problem is it takes the shift away from Christ and Jesus, what he did, and it moves it on to us. And that is the result when we don't properly understand the fact that everybody sins and why they sin. And what this does, if you've ever been around someone or this is part of your life, it creates spiritual anxiety in people because they feel they're not measuring up and they're just supposed to try a little bit harder to be that good person, that they're failing themselves, failing God. You know, those words of encouragement, to try harder, be better, you can do it. To me, it's like giving a person treading water in the deep waters and saying, okay, try harder, be better. And that what that looks like is giving them the 50-pound weight to hold above their head, which represents their sin, and saying, you can do it, try a little harder. Creates anxiety and inevitably they drown. Why? Because we all sin. We all know the shame and the reproach of sin. We sense it in our own lives. You know, when you're just being told you're just not doing enough, that's not the answer. That's a way to have anxiety and be crushed. And so much like what I would call modern-day Pharisees or overly righteous people or that kind of message, which I'm very much opposed to, we remove the meaning and the purpose of the cross that we keep up here. It removes the meaning and purpose of it. Trevin Wax says this about this. The problem with excising original sin from this picture is that it neutralizes the power of the cross. It makes the cross a call to new life, but not something that actually accomplishes anything. It's a call to new life rather than the gift of new life. The cross says, then be better. For those who deny original sin, the cross is about making kinda good people better. In the traditional understanding, the cross is about making dead people alive or live. So if we remove this doctrine of why people sin, you're taking away the power of the cross. That's what he's saying. And Jesus' sacrifice then only makes a new life possible, potentially obtained if you work hard enough and try hard enough. And like most overly righteous people and movements, the message becomes be better, try harder. The cross isn't about, the fact that everybody sins is not about you being better. The fact that everybody sins is about the fact that it necessitates you need a Savior. Daily, we need a Savior. And we have one if you believe in Him. But you can't be righteous enough. Everyone sins. Everyone was born a sinner. And everyone who hasn't accepted that truth is just like that person we said that's trying to tread water and being given that weight. And everyone who believes and confesses in Jesus Christ says, I can't do it. I'm a sinner. I know it. I don't want to be a sinner, but I am. And yes, pause here. Yes, there should be some sanctification, some progressive growth towards holiness in your life as a Christian. Why? Because you're a new creation. You should not be the same 10 years from now that you are today, but you will always have sin in your life. The people you love will always have sin in your life. And believing in Christ, then, the answer to not being overly righteous is to acknowledge that and realize what the gospel is. And the gospel is this. The gospel is that Jesus gets out of the boat, gets in the deep water with you, gives you His life vest, and then takes that 50-pound weight of sin off of you so you can be saved. And He says, I'll choose to be drugged down to the dark, cold depths of the ocean where I'll drown, and I'll do that for you. You cannot be overly righteous and believe in a message like that, and that's what the cross is. So admit your inability and to believe on Him. Now, I think the preacher puts here in verse 21, I think in response to saying everybody sins, I think he's going to prove it to us. Why does everybody sin? You want proof everybody sins? Here's what he's going to say. Do not take to heart all the things that people say, lest you hear your servant cursing you. Your heart knows that many times you yourself have cursed others. Okay, he's saying, don't get too riled up when people gossip or slander or talk behind your back. Even your servant, meaning even those closest to you in your house, your family, your close friends, coworkers, whatever it may be. And why? Because everybody sins. Don't be too surprised about that. One commenter writes it this way in regards to this verse. Let it go, because I hope you recognize that your friends must be talking behind your back, since you have done the same to them, right? Together, these verses teach us an even more sobering truth. Our tongue is only the tip of the iniquity iceberg. The proof that all humans are inescapably flawed is right between our teeth. That's good. So he's saying, hey, don't take it all to heart, right? People get tired. They have bad days. They have careless words they haven't thought through. Even those that love you are your friends, your family. And he's saying, forgive them. We're all sinners. And he's also saying, get off your high horse. You've not ever talked about anyone, you know? And he says, you don't have to look any further than that little thing that's in our mouth to know that we're a sinner. We can't even accomplish righteousness with our own tongue. And so the preacher has given us some wise words here, okay? But then he's going to go on to tell us that full wisdom, though, is unobtainable. In verse 23, he says, all this I have tested by wisdom. I said, I will be wise, but it was far from me. That which has been is far off and deep, very deep. Who can find it? Now, he says that wisdom is far off from him, very deep, but we know that not all wisdom has been, because Ecclesiastes has provided much wisdom on areas of life, and we've received them. During our study of Ecclesiastes, that we have had very clear moments of what the Bible's teaching and wisdom and how to be instructed. And those are passages that other pastors get to preach. Not today, though. But he's saying that, look, there's things that are very deep, very far off. I can't understand them. Right? This is a man that's supposed to be one of the wisest men ever in history saying this. And he can't figure out why good people die in their righteousness. He can't figure out why times wicked people extend their lives, the crooks can live long. All mysteries under life under the sun. But he says, I think the Bible says, and it gives us an answer to this, that the secret things belong to the Lord our God. Deuteronomy 29:29. And unless we want to spend our lives as Christians in frustration and toil, we just are going to have to accept that, much like the preacher, we can't explain all of the things under the sun in this world. It's for God to know. God knows the secret things. And you got to realize, for you to know those secret things, you then would be God, which we know is not possible for us. And so the preacher then turns to tell us about the scheme of all things. He says, I turn my heart to know and search out and to seek wisdom and the scheme of things and to know the wickedness of folly and the foolishness that is madness. So in verses 23 and 24, the preacher admits he cannot know everything. But then he turns around and he says, I'm still in a relentless pursuit, though, to seek to understand life under the sun. In verse 25, he says he sought to know and to search out and to seek. What is wisdom and what is foolishness? And he continues in verse 26, and I find something more bitter than death, the woman whose heart is snares and nets and whose hands are fetters, which would be like modern-day handcuffs, okay? He who pleases God escapes her, but the sinner is taken by her. So the preacher is speaking here clearly, I think, about the sinner who does fall prey to the adulteress, okay? However, this is not a generalized description of women per se, but he is using an example here, and it's a literal example that I think we all can understand once we're up to a certain age, the damage, the dangers of a young man or whatnot that falls to this type of temptation and sin and the harm that can come out of it. But I think it also means something more. There's a rhetorical device used in the Bible, and we call it personification, okay? And it's something that you see used often in the wisdom literature, the Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. And Solomon, of which, by the way, has a role in all of them. So I don't think it's a stretch to consider how this is being used. And personification, if you don't know, it's just taking an idea or an object and attributing human characteristics to non-human things. And so an easy example I might give you is if you've ever owned a boat or you've ever had a friend that owns a boat, often they'll talk about the boat in personification. She's been a good boat. Sorry to see her go. She's been good to me. Oh, I'll miss her. Sometimes they talk that way about their boat. That is what personification is. We do it. It happens in the Bible. And so one commentator says this, the seductive adulteress described here is more than a woman who tempts and traps men. Following Solomon's Proverbs in the book of Proverbs, the ensnaring woman in Ecclesiastes is the personification and embodiment of folly, whether sexual or otherwise. Just as the wise son keeps away from the house of the adulteress, so the wise person resists the traps of Lady Folly. So Proverbs uses this image of the adulterous woman, not only in that one specific tangible example, but as a larger picture of any vice, anything that would lead to destruction. So basically, the snares and fetters of drug or alcohol addiction, right? The snares of pornography or gambling addictions, right? The unrighteous pursuit of wealth, all of these things can be fetters. And so he says, the one who pleases God will avoid Lady Folly, whether it be the literal temptress or other snares. And you'll see that when you read Proverbs. There's actually this idea of this lady wisdom and lady folly and what goes under these personifications. So I want to say that it's that and more. And so we're not out of the woods yet. We have verse 27 where he says, behold, this is what I found, says the preacher, while adding one thing to another to find the scheme of things which my soul has sought repeatedly, but I have not found. One man among 1,000 I found, but a woman among all these I have not found. Now again, there's many different interpretations with plausible answers. Most commentators and scholars admit they can't be sure. And I do not believe that the point here is to say that women are more sinful than men. If it thought that, if it, I thought it meant that, I wouldn't like it, but I would tell you that. I don't think that's what it's saying. It may be another rhetorical device like exaggeration to get attention. Or maybe he does believe that he's found one good man in 1,000 and he hasn't found one in 1. Maybe it means that. But if you think about it, in all this contrasting that he's doing, wickedness, righteousness, it wouldn't really make sense to take 1,000 to compare men and women to say, well, I found one party, 0.1% better. That's not a good comparison. So I just don't think that's what it means. Some commentators do believe it's referencing men and women, their inability to avoid sin. And maybe, but I don't think so. In both verses 25 and 27, the preacher, in his search to understand, uses this word, schemes. And that word is not the way we usually think about it, which is like conniving or someone scheming. That's really not the word in the Hebrew. The Hebrew word is cheshbon, and it means a rational thinking and decision-making, thoughts, intents, or plans. And I think he's drawing, I don't think he's drawing a distinction between the levels of sinning between men and women, but the fact that he just can't figure men and women out. He can't figure humankind out under the sun. I think that's what he's means. And I think he set out to understand the cheshbon, what that is, the mysteries, the heart, its desires, motivations, and the thought processes that lead a man or a woman to folly or to sin. He wants to understand, and he's saying, I can't figure them out. That's what I think he's saying. And he says in verse 29, see this alone, I found that God made man upright, but they have sought out many schemes. And part of the confusion, part of the problem here is in verse 29, the word schemes shows up again for us, third time, but in the Hebrew, it's a different kind of schemes. This schemes in Hebrew actually does mean an intent or an evil intent. So it's just a little zoom into how all the passages have been. So in verse 29, I think verses 27 and 29, I'm going to say it in my own words. I think this is what the preacher's saying to us in verses 27 and 29. I think he's saying this. I'm going to summarize. Preacher's saying, I can't figure out the thought patterns of men or women and why they do what they do under the sun. I do know this, though. God made mankind upright, but man still has the propensity to sin. I think that's what he's saying. And I think a takeaway for us is we can't always understand the motives and reasons that people do things. I don't even think we can always understand our own motives in life and why we do and don't do some of the things we do. And so maybe here's a word of caution. When you observe something like the preacher's observing people and you make a conclusion based on your observation, maybe we have some caution in doing that because who can understand people? And we might arrive at a wrong conclusion. That's dangerous. And if we arrive to what we believe is a negative conclusion about that person based on what we observe, that's even more dangerous. If one of the wisest people to ever live can't figure people out, maybe we can't figure people out either. And so we might want to enter into that relationship or that situation, but we ought not to form decisions or conclusions on why people are doing what they're doing. It's hard to understand the heart and the motives of people. I mean, we are a mix of emotions, our upbringing, we're a mix of our sins, we're a mix of our understanding of the Bible and the Holy Spirit if we're saved, goals, value systems. So there's just a caution there, a statement in wisdom, I believe. And our verses, you know, today they haven't been easy. They haven't been easy. And though we may struggle through some of the more complicated parts and we're honest about it, there are things that are not complicated. There's things that are not complicated. And the fact is there was only one truly righteous person who died in his righteousness, right? There's only one person who never sinned. One person who's infinitely wise and good, Jesus Christ. And all of the mysteries and injustices we see in this life, we're not going to understand them and be at peace with them until we are with him. So there's hope for today. There's hope for the sinners. There's hope for the overly righteous. There's hope for the wicked. And that hope looks like confessing and believing in Jesus Christ of what I already told you, that he is the one that got out of the boat as an illustration, took your weight of sin, drowned for your sins so you could be saved, and you have been given new life. That's good news for the sinner and the one that hasn't come to believe. And it's good news for us who are Christians as we remember that when we look at these injustices and these things in our life. I know this, Christ did this for me. Christ did that for me. And I can live out of that. And then you become not potentially a new creation, you are a new creation. And so with that in mind, you live for him. Why? To put him in your debt? To put him in a box so he'll bless you? No, because he's the one that got in out of the boat for you, went onto the cross for you, and that's who he is. So it's a different motivation to be a person that does good and avoids wickedness, and all the while understanding we're not ultimately wise. So it's because you love him, because he first loved us and gave his life for us. Let's pray. God, we admit that these are difficult passages this morning, Lord, and I do pray for the help of your Holy Spirit that you would work in our hearts to point us back to Jesus, Lord, and to be okay with the things that we don't understand, Lord. As we look to Jesus, we can trust you who spared not your own son for us. How much more will you give us all things that you deem good for us, Lord? And that might even be at times a life that's not lived long. And we just submit to your authority. We give you thanks for the word. I pray that it would bless all of us this day, Lord, and every day. In Christ's name, amen.